like the length of this cord. Realize that you're among imperfect people, that you sit next to them, that they stand before you, that they sing, that they preach, and that's okay. Because if you believe today that you're imperfect, you're in the perfect place. It's almost July, and July is the month that we celebrate our independence by blowing up a small portion of it. And that means fireworks. And you've seen the fireworks booth out here, and want to invite you to get your fireworks here at New Hope. If you do, you're helping high school and junior high kids get to camp. You're also helping the folks at Celebrate Recovery get to their leadership conference. And so it's kind of a big deal for us. It's a big fundraiser for us. So if you're going to buy fireworks, especially knowing that Buchanan's not going to be setting theirs off this year, that's this big sad face. But yeah, if you're going to be celebrating that at home, please get your fireworks here. Speaking of CR, there is going to be no CR this Thursday, and that is because the Vacation Bible School stuff that's going on here, and they'll pick up again the following Thursday. For Vacation Bible School, you can see the booth outside if you want to get your kids signed up. If they're not signed up, if they are, you can tell that they're going to have a great time. Set is almost finished. We're going to be putting a tent up back there, and we've got a lot of great plans for these kiddos and a lot of great volunteers to minister to them and send them on their way. I was talking to a high school student just not more than a week ago, and she told me what her key verse was, her life verse. And she graduated this year, so she's moving on to college. She's going to school out in Arizona with a friend. And she said that her key verse, her life verse, was Joshua 1:9. And I remember that from years and years ago. We're probably talking 10 years ago, that Joshua 1:9, be strong and courageous, for the Lord your God is with you, was part of, it was our theme verse in a Vacation Bible School. And I said, is that where you picked that up? Is that where you remember that from? And she says, yes. And so realize that Vacation Bible School is a big deal to these kids. They remember it for a long, long time, and it serves them well. Other things going on at the church. Today, you're going to be hearing from Mr. Addis. He's an Englishman. I wonder, Mark, do they have a 4th of July in England? I suspect they do, just not an Independence Day, right? Yeah. So, yeah, look forward to hearing from him today. Other announcements. The World Changers, I don't know if we have that clipboard or if it got filled up, but the World Changers is coming up if you'd like to serve in that way by preparing something for them to eat. World Changers is a group of kids that come into town from all over the nation just to serve the low income in our area. And New Hope has agreed to feed, as we always do, two teams of those young people who are coming in to work on fences and fix roofs and that kind of a thing. So if you'd like to help feed them, you can contact me or the church office, and we'll get you on that clipboard. I'm pretty sure there's a handful of slots that we still need to feed. And by doing that, you would be saying that, yes, I'll bring drinks or dessert or the main item for that day for that team. So it's a team of 15 people, and you would only be providing a portion of their meal for that day. But together, you know, we can do these things. It's one of the great benefits, I think, of a church. And, you know, you hear some people say that I don't need church. I can go to church in God's big church. And what they're talking about is the mountains or the lake or whatever. And I think deep down we know that's kind of an excuse. But there's some things you can't do on your own, right? We can't support large mission groups on our own. We can't support, like, these kids at the World Changers. And so, but together we can do that. Many hands make light work. Speaking of missions, we have the missions fair out here just outside in the pavilion. Go outside and check that out on your way out there. There's a number of booths to see what kind of missions work we do here at the church. And you'll get to not only be apprised of that, but you'll get a little ticket for having been there and seen those things. You can take that ticket over to the helicopter that's parked out on the back lawn here. I don't know if you saw that when you came in, but there's a nice little helicopter out there. And there's a couple of buckets. You can drop your ticket in that bucket. And when will that drawing be? Next weekend, we're going to pull a name, a number from that, or a ticket from that bucket, and that'll get you a free helicopter ride. So that's kind of a neat deal. It's a cool incentive. Other things going on. Vacation Bible School, by the way, June 29th, and the hours are 9 to 11:30 in the morning. Fireworks booth will be open the 1st through the 4th, And we have canceled the barbecue that we normally have here at on the 4th of July. We normally would come and gather here and set off some fireworks and then just park our lawn chairs and watch the fireworks over coming over the trees from Buchanan. But there will be no fireworks coming over the trees this year, and so we've kind of put a postponement on that barbecue. You're still welcome to come and blow up a small portion of the church if you like, but there won't be any supervision here, so do that at your own risk. Homeless outreach on July 5th, and you can see all these things here in your bulletin under July. Somebody did a great job. Did you notice that they're a little different? No, they're not. Yeah, I like that. I just noticed that this morning. Senior luncheon on the 14th. Widow's lunch brunch on the 12th, and that's at the Phoenician Gardens. I've never been to Phoenician Gardens, so maybe I'll show up. Oh, wait, I'm not a widow. Parents' date night. Kids are having, is that a fundraiser? For junior high, and if you'd like to just go out and have some fun with your spouse, you can drop your kids off here at the church. They'll babysit them, entertain them, send them back all sugared up. And so enjoy your night out, because when you pick them up, they'll be very excited to see you. July 28th is the All Church Skate Night. It's been a long time since we've done something like that. I'm fairly excited about that. I remember when it was Roller Town, and I think it's Cal Skate now, is it? Yeah, so if you want to have just a good time, you show up. There's no tickets needed or anything like that. You just show up on the day, bring your kids, bring your grandparents. Whoever wants to break a hip, just bring them. And then we'll skate together. That's July 17th from 6:30 to 9. I'm sorry, July 28th. What? 6 to 8. Okay, there's no time on there, so note that on July 28th, 6 to 8. And that's at Cal Skate. Same place. Oh, $6 Christian music night. Christian music's getting cheaper. Awesome. July 31st and is the Jam Overnight Camp Out, and that's here at the church. Come set up your tent. You'll be roughing it in the woods. But that's a good time for family bonding stuff, too. Dads, bring your kids. It may not be your favorite night, but it just may be theirs. Junior high summer camp, last but not least, that's over at Meadow Ranch up at Hume Lake, and that is August 9th through the 15th. They've got a number of spots open, so if you have a junior high student in your family, let them know about that. Okay, I think I've told you everything that I want to tell you about. Checking my notes. Yes, did I miss anything? Oh, VBS, if you'd like to buy a shirt and you're not going to be a part of VBS, you can do that too. There's some extra shirts out there. All right, with that, I'm going to ask you to bow your heads as we pray, and I'll invite the folks to come forward as we prepare to receive our morning tithes and offering. And look how beautiful they are. Three of them belong to somebody I know. One of them's in junior high. Actually, he's going to be a freshman next year. Can you believe that? I'm so old. All right, let's pray. Father in heaven, you're holy. And when we confess that, God, we understand that we're saying that you're perfect and we're not. And you have a plan, God, that we don't yet understand. Because we don't see things necessarily the way that you do. But we trust you, God, in those times that your plan seems different than ours. And we thank you that because of the times we've trusted you in the past, that we believe we can continue to do that. When the future seems uncertain, God, when we realize that we're frail, God, when we feel like we failed, we know that you're there to pick up the pieces, Jesus, and we thank you for that. And it means so much to us, God, that it's hard to think about those who don't know you yet, who haven't learned, Jesus, that they can trust you. And so, Lord, we gather like this. We gather to praise you and remind ourselves that you're holy. We gather to hear your words so that we can learn your truth and know your will. And we gather so that we can spread your good news. And we can come together with fresh ideas and resources and send your name out into all the world. We thank you, God, that you not only allow us to do this, but you ask us to do this. Though, Lord, you're perfectly capable of doing it on your own. You want to use us. You want to show us how to be your kids in this place. Like a father teaching his son how to swing a hammer, you give us tasks to do. So Lord, as we give, I pray that we would give with humility. God, that anything that would be given stubbornly, we would just hold on to. But Lord, we would give with a happy heart, knowing, God, that those resources go out into all the world to say that your name is above all names. For you, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, and you're certainly worthy of our praise and all that we have to offer. As we sing, Jesus, I pray that you hear our voices, yes, but more so our hearts, because we love you, and we say it in that precious name. Amen.
Amen.
This last week, Jerry and I celebrated our 50th wedding anniversary. And 50 years ago, on the rolling plains of northeastern Montana, we were married.
24th, Wednesday.
Wednesday. And after we said our vows to one another and were pronounced husband and wife, we knelt at the altar and we sang the song we're going to sing this morning, Together, Life's Pathway. Also, I'd like you to know that my sister and brother-in-law are with us. My brother-in-law was the best man at my wedding, our wedding.
Stan.
And their oldest daughter, Kathy, and her husband, Mark. Kathy was a flower girl at that wedding.
Stand
so
up.
That tells you how long ago it is.
Stand up.
We'll be reading from Matthew 28, starting at verse 18, if you have a Bible. But first, I'd like to read an excerpt from a book that I highly recommend, Gods at War by Kyle Idleman. It basically talks about idols that we have in our lives that we worship more than we worship God. I'm just going to read the first part of chapter 7, which is the gods of entertainment. See if you can imagine this one. People arrive hours early for church. On Sunday mornings, they don't just set up an alarm clock to assure they wake up in time, but they set up a backup to the alarm clock. They arrange their schedules to make sure they don't miss gathering for worship. Throughout the week, they talk about what happened on the previous Sunday as excitement builds for the upcoming church service. There's all-day talk shows on the radio devoted to reviewing last week's service and breaking down this next one. There's even a TV show called Church Center that runs highlight clips of the church activities and what happened across the nation that day. When Sunday comes, the members start loading up their trucks, SUVs, and sedans hours before the service starts. Hurry, says Dad frantically, we're behind again. It's 6 a.m., says Mom. Church doesn't start for 5 hours. But last time we left at this time, we had to park 3 miles from the sanctuary and sit in the nosebleed seats. Someday I really want to sit in the front row, but you have to camp out on the church lawn for any chance of that. The roads are really congested on the way to church, no matter how early you leave. At church, there are vehicles parked as far as the eye can see, and folks are out tailgating. Some have elaborate spreads prepared, breaking out portable grills and lawn chairs in the church parking lot. We have television monitors and satellite dishes so they can catch updates from other worship services while they wait for their own. It's nice weather today. Not that it matters. Even in the dead of winter, they'll still be out here in the same numbers. The masses begin filling the sanctuary, cheering with great passion and excitement. Once the service starts, the people are all on their feet, not that they ever sit down. Of course, a bunch of young guys are in the front row. They've probably been here since Friday night. They have no shirts on, and each one has a letter on his chest, and together it spells, "Get your tithe on." Apparently, the rumor has gotten out that the pastor is indeed going to teach on biblical stewardship and worshiping God with your money. Everyone is pumped for the giving sermon. It's the highlight of the year. After several hours, people start looking at their watches, and everyone is thinking the same thing. I hope the sermon goes into overtime. I won't be, so. In fact, you might get out a little early today. It seems a little extreme, or does it? Nothing that we as a country don't do on a regular basis for a number of sports. To be on fire for a team, to feel every win and loss, so deeply that it could change your mood for the rest of the day or even the rest of the season. Don't get me wrong, I'm not knocking sports. I personally have a strong desire to watch Formula One cars go round and round a track for 2 hours, 19 times a year. But we see it every day, and we hear it every day. The overwhelming amount of information that we hold in our brains about something that we are passionate about, something that we are on fire for. So why not about Christ? What about a church? And I mean a church in a universal sense of the word, not just the New Hope community way. A church whose members will dedicate the vast amount of time and energy that we spend on learning other things, educating ourselves on the Bible, on the teachings of Jesus Christ, and on the playbook of our biblical MVP. I suggest that this would create a church that is on fire for God. I like the expression, on fire for God. It really invokes a true sense of complete abandonment, passion, and commitment. Luke 24, verse 32, talks about two men Jesus was walking with on the road to Emmaus after his resurrection. And they said to one another, "Did not our heart burn within us while he talked with us on the road and while he opened the scriptures up to us?" This is what God wants from every believer. If we are on fire and consumed with God, we are going to have the intimate relationship with God that he desires. I want to focus today on ministries, since this is our outreach ministry fair. I don't want to focus on the in-house, on-campus ministries. They're well-supported and well-known by many of the regular attenders. But today we'll look at the outreach ministries. Four of these are highlighted in the pavilion today. Take a look at them when you go outside. But think about what these four and other outside ministries do. What is the ultimate point of all these ministries? Why do we even call them ministries? Do they exist to help those in need of medical attention? Yes, they do. Do they exist to give clean water to those that don't have it? Absolutely, they do. Do they provide education and a career kickstart for those without resources? Of course. But why? I was asked this question fairly early on in the life of Aviation in Action. Why do you do this? Why do you give free flights to people that need to get to medical appointments? Why do you give scholarships for flight training for people wanting a flying career? Generally, it's a dream question for a ministry leader and one that you pray for. But this question led me to do an addendum to our mission statement. Our mission statement originally read, "Aviation in Action is a nonprofit founded to harness the power of aviation for education scholarships, medical transportation, and humanitarian air support." It tells people what we do. It tells them pretty clearly. But why do we do it? It doesn't tell anybody that. So we added, "The board members of Aviation in Action are dedicated to building an organization that is based on Christian principles." Consequently, one of the primary objectives of Aviation in Action is to help the gospel of Christ take flight worldwide through compassion and service to those in need. Much more complete. That tells people why we do what we do, not just what we do. So yes, we do want to help people get to go where they need to go, either in their career or for medical treatment. But we do it primarily because when Jesus said, "Love your neighbor as yourself," he meant it. We don't just do this because we can, or we feel like it's the right thing to do. It's absolutely the right thing to do. But we do it because our faith drives us, a passion and a fire that pushes us and shapes our lives. But what exactly does a mission-driven or missional life look like to a Christian? Is it packing up your family, selling off everything you own, and moving to Colombia or Uganda? Yes, it looks like that. Is it driving to Coalinga or Chowchilla to do a Bible study with 30 prisoners behind prison walls and explaining to them that Jesus loves them no matter what their situation, no matter what they've done? Yes, it looks like that. Is it walking across the street to a neighbor and inviting them to Sunday church so that they can hear the good news? Yes, it looks like that too. Our mission, what is it? It's written in Matthew 28. We start reading at verse 18. Then Jesus came to them and said, "All authority in heaven and earth has been given to me. Therefore go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I've commanded you. And surely I am with you always to the very end of the age. And therefore go make disciples of all nations." This is a nation, so it's encompassed, all nations. "And make disciples," a much stronger expression than just go out and tell someone about God and the Bible. When you make disciples, it's a process, and in this case means to teach. Bring them to a point of informed belief, and then when they believe, baptize them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. When someone becomes a disciple, they have a much deeper understanding and deeper faith, not a shallow one. The book of Mark, chapter 16, verse 15, mirrors this when he says, "Go into all the world and preach the good news to all creation." And backing up in Matthew, it's reiterated there where Matthew 24, 14 says, "And the gospel of the kingdom will be preached in the whole world as a testimony to all nations. And then the end will come." This squarely puts a spotlight on what the missional focus is: reaching the unreached people groups of the world. After all, until we do, we won't experience the glorious return of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. But many people will sit there and say, "What if I'm not part of a culture that's unreached? How do I influence the widespread and untouched people groups that we've been instructed to reach if I don't want to go to the villages in Africa or risk my life in a Muslim country?" These are good questions, and we should be asking questions like this instead of just ignoring it. So let's break down how these missionaries get to be in these distanced and untouched places in the world, and it usually begins in a very simple way. Someone talks to them about God, the Bible, or Jesus. Somebody. It's that simple. Someone had to be the first to tell them about God so that they could even be in the mission field in the first place. Something drew them to God, and invariably it was the influence of someone in their lives that they knew who was already a believer. Perhaps it was a parent or a Sunday school teacher, or maybe later in life, a co-worker, a pastor, a family member, or a neighbor. But whoever it was, they planted the seed, and the seed grew, nurtured by others along the way, and influenced and molded by the word of God. Finally, a day comes when they feel a whisper, the whisper of God coaxing them further afield. Perhaps a short mission trip, or perhaps a longer commitment to an underreached and underdeveloped country. The seed planter isn't there on the mission field with them. The nurturer isn't necessarily there on the mission field with them. And the person that provided financial support for them to be there isn't necessarily there. But does this make these people any less important to the work of Jesus Christ? No. It makes them instrumental in sending others. Not everyone wants to get on a plane and travel across oceans. And that's okay, as long as we realize that as Christians, that does not excuse us from the process. We all have a vital role to play in the bigger picture. To play a part in kingdom work, we must find a niche for ourselves in which we can excel. We should feel an obligation to tell people about eternal life. If you know the comedy team, Penn and Teller, Penn Jillette is one half of that comedy team, and he's quite well known for his advocacy of atheism. However, even he, one time in an interview, said, "If you believe that there's a heaven and a hell, and that people could be going to hell or not getting eternal life or whatever, and you think that, well, it's not really worth telling them because it would make this social situation very awkward. How much do you have to hate somebody to believe that everlasting life is possible and not tell them that? He has a point. We have the incredible knowledge of the truth, and we need to share it. Why would we not feel an obligation to tell people, knowing that the alternative they have is dire? Even an atheist in this case will tell you that it can only appear that we must hate people if we do not share this with them. But let's get back to the building of a missionary. Let's start with Sunday school teachers. Someone that offers time and energy on a Sunday morning to provide more than just childcare. For over an hour on a Sunday morning, they strive to bring new information to a child's life. Bible stories broken down into life meaningful sections, interwoven with crafts and skits to help kids relate the Bible to their everyday lives. It's sometimes done by people who teach for their jobs, but often it isn't. When you think about the role of a Sunday school teacher and their influence on a potential missionary, it's huge. How many of you sitting here remember your Sunday school teachers? Or how many of you remember when you gave your life to Christ in a Sunday school environment or at a children's camp, a Christian camp? For many kids, Sunday school is the only concentrated time they get to hear or talk about God in their week. It's planting the seed and over time, nurturing it. Vacation Bible School starts this week, 5 days, 2.5 hours a day for kids that may not necessarily come to church on a regular basis, to be immersed in the Christian faith and to do a lot of activities that they'll find a lot of fun, but they'll also remember the message behind it. Next Sunday, we have 14 kids heading up the mountain to camp, and they'll have 4 complete days of immersion. And they'll do a lot of fun songs and games, activities in chapel. And right there, some of them will commit their lives to Christ, and some won't. But for the ones that don't, they'll come home and think about the fun that they've had. They'll think about Bible stories and activities, and if nothing else, they'll come away more informed than they were when they left. They know the truth. They just need to take the final step of acceptance. Many will at some point, and this is the first step to a fire within them that will carry them through becoming a mature Christian and potentially even a missionary. So many influences along the way contribute to that. Next, I want to look at small groups. We have so many small groups here at New Hope. The small group environment is one of learning, not just of study books and videos, but also from the people around. They create an atmosphere of sharing, encouragement, fellowship, and often will bring people closer and on fire for God. Some of the small groups here have taken on ministries that make a true difference, some of them here in the community, and some of them further afield in other countries. It would be difficult to preach about outreach at New Hope and not talk about the Actis family. A New Hope family that is now entrenched in Uganda after leaving a thriving ministry in Colombia in the capable hands of local people that were discipled by them. But have they always been overseas missionaries? No. Matt was a teacher here in the community. They started the homeless ministry that's now served by so many people here every month. As well as the Holy Spirit that drove them, there were people that influenced their lives, helped teach them, and provide them with the tools that they needed and the financial means that they needed. So it wasn't by accident. It was a spark which was nurtured into a fire and led some incredible changes with a passion for people who needed to know the Word of God. So we all have an important role to play in with our faith, and we must open ourselves up to doing just that. We cannot simply be Sunday Christians. We cannot sit here and believe with conviction on a Sunday, only to forget everything the rest of the week until we pull into the parking lot next Sunday. The role of the gathering on Sundays is not church. We are the church, again, in the universal sense of the word. Sunday provides an opportunity to come to a place of teaching, encouragement, and preparation for the work outside of this campus and outside of these walls. We don't want to be restrained by a Sunday. It's a time to prepare for kingdom work, and it should be a pep rally so that we're enriched and ready to hit the mission field, on fire for God so that the light that is Christ shines through us so clearly that people cannot possibly ignore it. The mission field starts at the door. It starts with outreach. And here at New Hope, we do just that. We reach out to those in need, and when we reach out to others, we hold in our hands the truth of the gospel. Through our church finances, it shows that we reach out. The ministries our members here support and participate show that we reach out. But more critically, we have leadership that reaches out. Our senior pastor, Tim, leads us to reach out every time he leaves in February to go to the Ivory Coast to work alongside the people of 1040 Initiative. Gil reaches out into the communities in Mexico. Jean reaches out to the hospitals, seniors' homes, and through the Clovis Police Chaplaincy. Robert reaches out through his leadership on countless youth missions. And Shelley reaches out to prisoners behind the walls. We're not short of mentors here at New Hope, for they do so many ministries outside of our own walls. We have good examples to follow. The mission field starts at the door. The logistics of sending missionaries either here or abroad requires volunteers, organizers, financial support, supplies, and importantly, prayer. We all have a part to play. We don't have to be the boots on the ground in the unreached countries, or the prisons, or the rescue missions, but we must be engaged in the Great Commission in some capacity. David Livingstone, Dr. David Livingstone, was a famed British explorer. Had to get someone British in here. So he was part of the expression, Dr. Livingstone, I presume, as said by Henry Stanley, after Stanley had been searching for him for a long time in Central Africa and finally found him in Tanzania. Livingstone was well known as a missionary in Africa as well as an explorer. Someone who explored the interior of Africa and promoted Christianity, commerce, and civilization. He was active on the African continent in working to help reduce the African slave trade from the source. He is revered as one of the great missionaries. So ironically, he only had one recorded person that he converted to the Christian faith. Only one. But even though there was only one, the one that he did convert made a lot of waves. His name was Seychelles, and he was the chief of the Kwena people in Botswana. After some initial rocky times between Livingstone and Seychelles, including Livingstone forcing him to abandon his tradition of polygamy by divorcing four of his five wives, which incidentally he ended up baptizing, Seychelles remained steadfast in his Christian faith. Neil Parsons of the University of Botswana said that Seychelles did more to propagate Christianity in 19th century southern Africa than virtually any single Christian European missionary. But think about that comment. Livingstone was a single European missionary. So admittedly, he only had one recorded conversion to Christianity on his record. But that one conversion is now responsible for the widespread Christianity of the southern part of Africa continent. How many more did he need than that one? Seychelles took that seed and he planted it far and wide, and Dr. Livingstone's work was multiplied. Go and make disciples, or in this case, a disciple, who will multiply your efforts and multiply God's kingdom. What I'm suggesting is that if you don't feel like your gift is evangelism, then find one person who you know can spread the word much more efficiently than you can and disciple them. Find the multiplier. Although having said that, let's not forget that we as Christians have a duty to proclaim our faith in God. So resting at one person, one new believer, and hoping there will be the multiplier of disciples isn't enough. If we believe that the Bible is true, and as Christians we must believe the Bible is true, then we have a responsibility and a duty to others to help others understand this truth. But think about how things have changed since Livingstone was hacking his way around the jungles of Africa without communicating with anyone for 6 years because there was not exactly mailboxes there. What a time we live in now. If ever there was a time that we could get the message to the ends of the earth, it must be right now. With modern forms of communication, with aircraft that can take off in one place, fly 10,000 miles and not stop for fuel, with vehicles that can overcome any kinds of terrain, what are we waiting for? What is it that is confusing about the message? It's believed that 16,000 people groups exist in the world right now, 6,000 of which are still unreached. One roadblock that has been there for professional overseas missionaries is that many countries won't issue Christian worker visas. In fact, even in Colombia, the Actis family came across that situation. They don't want Christian missionaries there proclaiming the words on the street or in public places. So how do we get missionaries there? We get them there through our brothers and sisters in Christ that go for other reasons. Business travel and tourism provide unique opportunities to bring the gospel to unreached people groups, or in some cases, unreachable. North Korea is a place that very few people go. Business travelers can go. Christian workers for sure cannot go there. Most primarily Muslim countries won't accept Christian workers, but tourists and business travelers are welcome. Christian tourists and business travelers. 1040 Initiative is a nonprofit, a Christian-based nonprofit, but for the purposes of their work in Morocco, they are just a nonprofit who helps with water, medical, and educational welfare in parts of that country. 99% of Morocco's population adhere to the Islamic religion. The 1040i workers don't openly preach like they do in the villages in the Ivory Coast. But they do pray for one simple question. Why do you do this? Why do you come and help us? Because our faith drives us. Because we believe that Jesus is Lord, and he told us to go and spread the gospel. And that our sins are forgiven through the blood shed on the cross. I'm not saying that when I travel to Asia on business, and I've been fortunate enough to do that in recent years, that I'm out there telling them about Jesus. I only wish I could tell you that were true. But now I look at this as wasted opportunities. When I was 19, I traveled extensively around India, and I was surrounded constantly by huge numbers of people from all different religions, but not Christianity. I saw poverty like I'd never seen it before, as well as going to Mother Teresa's orphanage in Calcutta. But back then, I was too intent on my own experiences, too intent on myself. What wasted opportunities they were. If only I knew then what I know now, the story may have been very different. It's hard, I know, to even speak to other co-workers about our faith. It's hard to speak to some family members about our faith. So speaking openly about our faith in countries where you could be jailed or killed for doing so seems somewhat impossible. But we must. There were men who followed Jesus and then scattered after the resurrection and ascension of Jesus to go and spread the word. And one by one, they were killed for their faith. And we have to ask ourselves, why would these early missionaries be so inclined to walk to their own death for the sake of the mission unless they so deeply believed in Jesus Christ? Most witnessed firsthand the resurrection of Jesus, so they knew the truth. They had no doubts and were willing to put their life on the line. Not just a handful of them, but all of them. No compromise. No walking away and just opting for a comfortable life. They were on fire for Jesus. They knew the truth because they had seen it. Some even wrote about it so that others, us, can know about it. Yet too often we sit here 2,000 years later and question the truth. How? It seems so easy now to question it because we just read about it. But men gave their lives to make sure that we knew the sacrifice Jesus gave for us. It would seem far more appropriate that we should do the same. Or at the very least, find the courage to stand up in our own culture, a culture where mere criticism is usually the sharpest weapon. We don't have to be alone to stand up and reach out to others. There are numerous ministries doing just that every single day. And they're fulfilling the needs of the people, as well as fulfilling the Great Commission, as told by Jesus in our text. If you still aren't convinced it's valid to be a missionary in your home, in your own home, Acts 13 tells us about Paul and Barnabas traveling to Cyprus. They went as missionaries, but Barnabas was from Cyprus. He was a missionary in his own country. There are people within 1 mile radius of your front door who need to know that there is hope, that the Lord will forgive them of any and all of their sins because Jesus paid the price. They need to know that we, as followers of Christ, will help them. They need the love of God and the support of non-judgmental, faith-filled people. And the people that are on fire for God, so they can feel the passion. So whether you just travel 1 mile from your house into a mission field, or 1 mile down a runway to reach a distant people group, the mission field starts at the door. Dare to be on fire for the Lord. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we are privileged to be here today as your servants. Please help us to feel the fire within so that we can help others to feel the same. Send us out of this building with a conviction to be part of the process and part of the Great Commission, either home or abroad. We pray for the church, the universal church. We pray for a unified church. We thank you, Lord, for the opportunities that we have to serve. And we pray this in the incredible name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Have a great day.